Well, if you thought our last Arby's video was overkill, just wait for this one. We had so many commenters telling us that we did not overkill the Arby's sauce cup problem enough, or that we went too far and could have done the problem a simpler way. So here goes round two. We extend the Arby's sauce solution in a few different ways to better understand the problem, and then we find an even more optimized solution than we did last time. We also explore a common misconception, something that many viewers suggested in the comments as a correct solution, but it turns out not to be correct. By the end of this video, we will have greatly improved the design of the paper condiment cup to maximize the amount of sauce if we are restricted to a flat base and a straight side. But stay tuned for a part three, where we extend our exploration to cups with more sides and even to curves. We'll also take on the rigidity problem in another video as well. So, are you ready to earn some more stickers for your nerd helmet? Because here goes a second round of Math Overkill. Well, if you haven't seen the original Arby's Paper Cup Optimization Overkill video, you may want to watch that first. The link is in the description below. As a brief recap, my son, Spencer, was unfolding some of the pleats on a paper condiment cup to open it up more and hopefully put more sauce in the cup. I wondered what angle he should fold the sides out to in order to maximize the amount of sauce it would hold. Assuming that the sauce only filled to the top of the cup, we found that folding out the sides to about 41 degrees gives the optimal amount, which almost doubles the amount of sauce you can put in the cup, from 17.67 cc's to 33.23 cc's. And that doesn't even include what you could pile over the rim if you're using a thick sauce like ketchup. Now, I thought I was the only person to have wondered about this question. That was really pretty arrogant of me to think that I was the only one. So many people responded in the comments that they had thought of this, or even solved it, or new teachers that had used this problem in a math class. I apologize for being so arrogant, and I'm pleased to know that there are so many like-minded nerds out there, and I'm happy to be one of you. So last time we took on this adventure to get some stickers on our nerd helmet, but we were far from getting enough stickers to compete with this viewer that sent us pictures of his actual nerd helmet. So we need to do some catching up and get our nerd helmet some more decorations. Many of you commented about how we could extend this problem or take into account other aspects of the situation, like the viscosity of the sauce. So here's the list of things on our plate to go through. 1. Understand why maximizing this cross-sectional area will not get us the angle that maximizes the volume. 2. What if we assume the sauce is quite viscous and makes a cone on top of the cup, then how does that optimal angle change? And 3. What if we could change the size of the base as well as the angle of the sides? Then how much more sauce could we get in the cup? And what angle would be ideal in that case? Well, let's start with number 1. Many commenters said that we could have just maximized the cross-sectional area, and that the angle that maximized the cross-sectional area would be the same angle that maximized the volume. Some viewers even found the optimal angle to maximize the area, and found it was not the same as what we came up with, and wondered why. Well, in short, the area of the cross-section is not proportional to the volume of revolution. The area of the cross-section is proportional to the volume for other shapes, such as a prism. But the reason it isn't the case for volumes of revolution is because sections of cross-sectional shape generate different volumes. A piece near the axis doesn't generate as much volume as the same-sized piece far from the axis of rotation. A simple counterexample to show that the area is not proportional to the volume of revolution is a long thin rectangle, rotated about the short side, versus rotated about the long side. The one with the long edge clearly generates a lot more volume even though the cross-sectional area is the same. Okay, now to number 2. I got virtually screamed at by commentators that said we needed to be more serious about viscosity of the sauces. I had Arby's sauce in mind when I first did the problem, and it's not as viscous as a sauce like ketchup, which is what a lot of viewers were thinking about. The higher the viscosity of the sauce, the higher it can be piled above the rim of the cup, presumably in a shape that approximates a cone. This can change the optimum angle because the larger the rim, the higher the cone of sauce that can be made. One of our fans created a video where he did some experimentation with ketchup to find the angle of repose is about 30 degrees. Then he solved the problem assuming the cone shape of sauce above the rim. You can watch that video with a link in the description. I don't want to give away his solution here. For our next problem, we will do it both ways, assuming the sauce goes to the rim and assuming an angle of 30 degrees on a cone-shaped top with a viscous sauce. And this takes us to number 3. What if we didn't have to keep the radius of the base the same? We still only have the same amount of paper to work with, so as we increase the radius of the base, then the length of the side must decrease. That means we could start with a wide, flat cup or a tall, skinny cup, but for each choice of radius, there is a different choice of optimal angle. For example, if the radius of the base was 0, then our sauce cup would just be a cone. finding the angle that maximizes the volume of the cone is almost 55 degrees. At the other extreme, if the radius of the base was almost the radius of the paper, then the sides are very short. The 4-centimeter radius paper had a 3.9-centimeter base radius and a 1-millimeter side length, the optimal angle is almost zero, just 1.4 degrees, so not worth trying to mess with at all. You can probably guess that as the ratio of the radius of the base and the radius of the paper gets closer to 1, then the optimal angle gets closer to 0, or in other words, closer to perpendicular to the table. This is the kind of problem where we could earn a sticker for our nerd helmet by setting up and evaluating a limit to find that the optimal angle should be going to 0, as I claimed. So what radius of the base and what angle of the side maximizes the volume? This is a multivariable calculus problem. In our last video, we just had one variable that impacted the volume, the angle of the sides. But now we're optimizing over two variables, because the volume depends on the radius of the base and the angle of the side. We can create a formula for the volume given the radius of the base and the angle of the side by using some trigonometry and the volume for the frustum of a cone, the same formula we used last time. We are going to assume that we have the same size of paper to work with as last time, which had a total radius of 4 centimeters or a diameter of 8 centimeters. This allows us to represent the length of the side of the cup in terms of the radius of the base. If we know the radius r, we can subtract the value from 4 to find the side length, so 4 minus r is the side length. From there, we use this right angle and this angle here to find the other values we need, the height and the radius of the rim. If we let x represent the radius and y represent the angle, then we can graph the volume function over these two variables, but what we get is a surface, not a curve. In a 3D model like this, the x and y coordinates are represented in a horizontal plane, while our output, which is the volume, is the height above or below the xy plane. We want to find the maximum value, but honestly, this thing looks pretty crazy. One thing we can do to simplify what we're looking at is to change the domain of our function. The value of our radius is between 0 and 4, and the value of our angle in radians is between 0 and pi halves. It might be hard to see, but as we move the graph around, it looks like there is one point on this bump that's higher than any other point. The point represents the maximum volume of our cup, but we need to find the inputs that give us that point, or the x and y coordinates that are directly on that highest point. We could try to narrow it down and get close by putting in a plane and raising the plane until there was a very small area left. That would allow us to approximate that value. But if you've had multivariable calculus, you learned how to use partial derivatives to find maxima or minima in situations like this. The multivariable strategy is an extension of the single variable technique, where we can find the derivative, set it equal to zero, and solve. Since derivatives tell us about how a function is changing, either increasing or decreasing, then we can look for values where the change is zero, so it's neither increasing or decreasing. It's more complicated for a multivariable function, though. If we move along the surface from this point and in this direction, we would find that this point here is where we max out. But we would get a different point if we started here and moved in the same direction, or we started here and went in this direction. There are a lot of places where we could travel across our surface where we max out. How can we find the absolute max in this portion? The absolute max is the point where traveling in either direction, we get a max at the same point. We can use that idea to build a strategy. Let's find all the points that give us maximums when we travel in one direction, say parallel to the x-axis, and find all points that give us maximums traveling in the other direction, say parallel to the y-axis, and find out if there is a point that is common to both of those. We can find the maximum points using partial derivatives. Partial derivative assumes that only one variable is changing and that the other variables are constant. When the partial derivative with respect to the radius, which we've labeled x, is equal to zero, it will give us a curve along a ridgeline where we hit maximums. Similarly, when we take the partial derivative with respect to the angle, which we've labeled y, and set it equal to zero, we get another ridgeline where these two ridgelines cross, then that is where our maximum lies. We find that the inputs that get us the maximum volume to be a bit different than the original cup measurements. The value of the radius goes from the original 1.5 centimeters to 2.14 centimeters. The side length shrinks from 2.5 centimeters to about 1.86 centimeters. The optimal angle for the sides to maximize volume is down from 41 degrees to about 32 degrees, so the sides are not as far out as what we found in the last video. Making these adjustments improves the volume from our previous optimum of 33.23 cubic centimeters by another 1.5 cubic centimeters to a total of 34.73 cc's. That's not a great improvement. But we haven't taken into account the viscosity of the sauce yet. We can do better if we adjust our model to have a cone-shaped overfill. So let's do some overfill overkill for another nerd sticker. It isn't too hard to add a cone to our volume formula. The volume formula for the cone top is the area of the base times the height divided by 3. The radius at the rim of the cup is the same as the radius of the base of a cone, so the area of the base is the radius squared times pi. If we use the 30-degree angle found by fellow nerd with the handle at CooperGiles-MV3JN, then we can find the height by multiplying the radius of the base times the tangent of 30 degrees. Before we can add this to our cup volume, we need to write the rim radius in terms of the base radius. We already know this form from our previous calculations. Now we can add the volume of the cone top to the volume formula for the cup, and do the same process we just went through to find the optimal values. The optimum design changes with our cone top, with a radius of about 2.2 centimeters now and a side length of 1.8 centimeters, and an optimal angle of about 52 degrees. That is open a lot more than the previous cups, because a wider opening adds so much to the volume of the cone top. This gets us a total volume of about 58.7 cc's. That's 230% more than the original cup filled to the brim. That just saved us multiple trips to the condiment counter, and we just earned another sticker for our nerd helmet. Well, there are still improvements we can make. We have to figure out how to get the unfolded cups to stay in the optimal shape when they're full of sauce. But that'll have to wait until next time. We'll end with a chance for you to earn one more sticker for your nerd helmet. Many viewers guessed that the optimal angle for the original problem in the last video was 45 degrees. Well, 45 degrees is the answer for some base radius. So my homework problem for you is to find the base radius of the cup where 45 degrees optimizes the volume of sauce in the cup. Thank you for watching. Please subscribe and share our videos. Be sure to follow Math the World on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook. Thank you so much for your support.